86% of organizations plan to prioritize data unification in the next year to improve their AI readiness. They're using strategies like API integration layers, data lakes and lake houses architectures, and enterprise data warehouses. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead and principal analyst at theCUBE Research, and I'm joined today by AB from MinIO. AB, how you doing?
Wonderful, Paul. Great to be back here again.
Great to have you on. Would you like to introduce yourself and introduce MinIO?
Yeah, I'm AB. I'm one of the co-founders and co-CEO of MinIO. MinIO is a household name in the enterprise infrastructure, particularly around AI data. We are powering some of the largest AI infrastructures in the world, quietly storing exabytes of data. Most people are using it without knowing we are the brand behind, we are the tech behind. It's basically about storing exabytes of AI data, and we are the largest by adoption in the world.
AB, it's great to have you on. I mean, we have a very important topic to talk about today. And as organizations race to capitalize on the AI boom, the growing consensus is emerging that not just models, but it's the ultimate differentiator. So according to our 2025 study, we find that 86% of organizations are prioritizing data unification as the core part of their AI strategies.
Yeah.
Would you agree with that?
Absolutely. Right. In the past, I think the last 2 years, they jumped into the AI right away. They focused on compute and then quickly came to the realization that those GPUs were idling out when the data was not ready. It's not like these organizations did not have data at all. They even embraced data practice in the past, but that data was not ready for this GPU world. Data being in different sources, different silos, you would have heard the term data swamp, data leak initiatives in the past were kind of a failure. And now AI is pushing them to rethink the data strategy, and that's what is going on.
Yeah, absolutely. And when we think about this, there's organizations that have their heritage environments, their current environments, there's a lot of different areas for things to kind of connect together. But why is data considered the company's most valuable asset in this AI era? Why does it influence the infrastructure decisions? Well, why do you think?
Yeah, I think if you always look back into the history, we learn a great deal. If you see what's happening in the enterprise today, is always a reflection of what happened with the consumer market in the past. Right? Enterprise used to be clunky, heavy, inefficient. And very early on, when the consumer world adopted the web, just email, when it was Hotmail, it became more accessible. Like every exec would have an Hotmail account too, right? From there, you saw SaaS became very real. From SaaS, it became mobile apps and tablets, CEOs and board members, execs brought iPads that was banned into the organization. You couldn't put organization data in those devices that had kids' games and apps along the side, right? We couldn't stop it. Why? Because it was productivity. The same thing is now starting to happen in the enterprise too. Look at the consumer world. If you look at Instagram, WhatsApp, any of those apps, right? TikTok even. How can they possibly give a service of that magnitude? I pay like $100, $200 a month for my telephone bill. Here, WhatsApp is doing free international calls, video calls, and it's free. How is that even possible, right? The data pays for everything multiple times over and gives them insane amount of profit. It happened in the consumer world. Enterprises are now waking up to it and taking ideas from the consumer world. In the long run, I think the enterprise and the consumer world will blur. Consumer world will always be on the leading edge and waiting because they don't have a choice.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that these two kind of universes are colliding, so to speak, right? You know, we have the productivity elements that you use in your personal life is working in your professional life. And that also introduces the concept of data connectivity and really how it's reshaping traditional approaches to data storage, security, and accessible. But what does this mean for scale?
The data connectivity, if you see, it's still an emerging topic, but interestingly, right, they even pushed the idea of data mesh. On paper, it sounded great, right? I have some data in HubSpot, some data in Salesforce, some in Zendesk, and all kinds of like Office 365 and my on-prem edge. The problem was that the data, while they had the data, it was not accessible. It's also the part of the unification strategy. They thought that there is one way to unify. If I just make all those APIs available centrally to AI, can I then have AI practice? Apparently not. Just having APIs available is not enough. GPUs, are hungry. They need the more data you can give to it, the more unification, more context you give to it, the more intelligence you get out. Just having access to the data through the API is not sufficient. It's why the ideas like data mesh failed, because every system had different APIs. This is even pre-Gen AI. Now with the Gen AI, like MCP servers, AI can figure out even different APIs and talk to them. What's the problem then? Data in different systems, in different formats, they come very slowly. They're literally like dripping into the GPUs, right? Or even to the models, it's not useful. You need to bring all your data, make a copy of this data. It happened already during the big data world. Make all of the data, could be your call center logs, it could be audio recordings, it could be your financial transactions, all the way to the historic context of entire customer data. The more context you have, the more unrelated data. Sometimes even the external data sources you buy, it could be geo data, it could be weather related data, health data. It affects your business. It's not an isolated. Your business is no longer isolated. The more data you bring into one unified pool, then you ask, how do I connect to it? Some of the initiatives the industry is already figuring out, these things are happening particularly in the enterprise space more than the consumer. There it is about like standardization, open APIs, all the data in one place. The things, if you track around Iceberg, for example, is exactly solving these problems. Once the data is in one place, then you can unlock the model AI ability to go turn that data into information.
Yeah, 100%. I think that the thing that we have to kind of double click down into here is the fact that when we use things like MCP and A2A or agents to agents to kind of start doing this communication, it's really about bridging the gap between old and new, right? When we look at heritage systems, and heritage systems are built around a certain way of compliance, regulation, and governance. Mm-hmm. And then if you extract that data out using a tool, whatever it may be, or an agent, if that information is extracted out, what happens to that governance and controls and regulations? That's a big challenge, I think.
Yeah. Like when they were in different systems, even the policy, if I have to give Paul some access to this data, some access to that data, and over there, over here, it's not even possible to come up with a unified policy language. Ideas like that have been explored and has been a failure. A universal policy engine and policy document across the organization, when data was in different systems and different APIs, every system had their own policy mechanism, their own security mechanism. It was a mess. They couldn't do it. And it was also holding the organization back. But now this topic has become more important because now you are having all of the data unified in one place. It's very easy to have a data breach that's of the largest scale you've ever seen. Compliance and governance and security has become more important than ever, but also has become easier. Now that the data is unified, you can have one policy that tells you have access to this warehouse data, this namespace data, that table data. You can now set one policy because data is in one place, and one policy, simple definition. The policy can only work if you have simple identity, simple policies that anyone can understand. Historically, this has been a complicated configuration. Anything, a firewall is only as good as how easy it is to use. It's not how secure, how powerful it is, it's how easy it is. Now it is finally within the reach because of the data unification, but it's more important than ever because if someone had access to your data source, you're talking about the entire history, entire data, a breach here, you can't even apologize to your customers.
Yeah, and no, absolutely. In the research that we're seeing at theCUBE Research, we find that complexity and skill gap issues are the main challenges that organizations run into. I think when we talk about the movement of data, the connectivity of data, and the access to this information, as well as bridging the gap between old and new, we have to also think about other risks, right? So what do you see are like some other risks that really focus solely on AI models, then, like, rather than rethinking your data architecture as part of your AI strategy?
Yeah, I think the risk part is actually a topic of hot debate today. It's like this is Europe right or US right? Right, Europe is thinking harder about the risks. US is thinking harder about innovation, and you can see that OpenAI was born here. Why? Because we focused on innovation and not risks. If you thought about risk, OpenAI won't be here, right? Anthropic won't be here. Any of these innovation won't be here. Enterprises are going through similar challenges. How careful I should be? Should I innovate? I think the right approach would be you should actually embrace innovation. But then it does not mean that risks are not important. You have to make risk a function, make risk the easier to implement and control. Don't make risk come in the way. Risk is important, but risk should be a function that if it doesn't help, it shouldn't hurt innovation. Those organizations are going to succeed. Look at just the full self-driving data, right? For cars, we know that when 1% of the failure of your drive can lead to accidents. And these accidents are, like in software, we call fatal errors, fatal bugs. This is really fatal error, right? In the AI model, people die because there are bugs in the system. But if you worry about risks, you will not have automation. So it's a function of get it out, but then take risk as an important function, but not come in the way of innovation of your AI adoption.
I agree 1,000% with what you just said, because I think the innovation is key, but you have to mitigate the risk on top of it. Now, I will say that there's challenges that you run into, such as, you know, from an app dev perspective, right? From an application development perspective, there's rules and regulation that are being put in place. Take, for example, the EU CRA. Even though that's focused in the EU, applications that are interacting globally have to take into consideration some of those compliance and regulations rules. I mean, by December 2027, all applications have to comply to the EU CRA rules, right? That's an interesting kind of perspective. It's risk, right? It's walking, going on the error on the side of risk, but it's also saying, well, if you're innovating with a purpose, innovating with these things in place. And yes. I think that comes down when we, again, back on the data side, when we look at consolidating enterprise data, right? And we put it all under that one roof kind of scenario. Do you think this gives organizations a competitive advantage or a competitive edge, especially when you're looking at AI, or is it okay to be distributed and everything everywhere?
Yeah, I think we are moving into an era where data centers now have a real purpose. They are called data centers. We always called them data centers. The birth of computing was actually around data, but for a long part of the history, it was about compute. We should have called them compute centers, right? But now it has become more than ever. If you look into any of the modern enterprise, like think about an app like Uber, right? Calling a cab through an app, a single Postgres database can handle all of that data. Right, even if it's a retail giant like Walmart, all the items on the shelf, their price tag and stuff like that, you could fit it in a single database. Why do they have exabyte of data? I think that's an important question to ask. Why they could have easily eliminated all that data and shrunk their infrastructure to a very simple setup. And all they need is apps. Apps are running on the cell phone and the central backend is very small. They actually put data to their advantage. The data that they collect every minute, every transaction, it actually runs the business. It is not a new concept. People report to computers in these organizations because computers make decisions based on the data. What has happened in the last 2 years, particularly last 1 year, is AI has shown the ability to turn different kinds of data, the ability to extract information from the data has reached a whole new fold. That is why it's more than ever, you have to bring all your data and treat data as your asset. Is not your infrastructure, is people are actually, I would say, still an important part, but even in people, you basically have the people who embrace and combine them with AI to increase efficiency. But without data, you have a lot of people, you have a lot of compute, it means nothing in the modern world.
And I think that the follow-on question to that really does come down to, like, when you're thinking about AI models and AI, mm-hmm. and an AI first kind of approach, how does the idea of compute power set the pace for data sets, or is it a ceiling? Is the compute power really like the end user piece? And does that really redefine what an AI first kind of approach would look like?
It's an important question. Most organizations don't understand, particularly the enterprise. The consumer companies, they understand, right? If you see, if I'm talking about my customers, my financial transactions, like if I even run a restaurant chain, all of the history, if I don't have that data, because those are customers who came, paid, and they left, what's a big deal, right? The more data I keep, that is the one that is feeding my business. The important part that the consumer industry understood was intelligence is a function of data size, right? The more data you have, it actually gives you like the emergent behavior we saw with even the models themselves, right? When the GPUs were just mediocre GPUs, just 2 years before, 3 years, 5 years before, the GPU is not a new concept, they existed. But the GPUs 5 years before and the GPUs today, you see, they are significantly better. What, if you had known that we would have gotten human-like intelligence, maybe not to even that level, but to where we are today, if we had known this better, NVIDIA or Intel or AMD would have produced the same GPU we have today, even 10 years before, 20 years before. We simply did not know we will get this emergent behavior beyond certain size. But it happened after some of these researchers never gave up. They kept doing this, kept doing this. Suddenly it showed up, the emergent behavior showed up. It even surprised the researchers. This is the same pattern you see with the data. The companies, even the social media, for example, right? You only have 10 million users. Doesn't mean anything. You have 20 million, 100 million, doesn't mean anything. 100 million to 500 million to a billion. Suddenly, even the data you thought junk was not very useful, that suddenly cat videos are important part of your fabric, right? Try deleting some cat videos out of these TikTok and Meta, Instagram. It can make headlines. The data, once it reaches certain capacity, that's when it starts to show the emergent behavior, emergent property of the information held inside the system. Most enterprises did not know how to deal with this. They didn't just understand this basic concept. The consumers understood this. Enterprises are now finally realizing this. Also, AI has made it easier to unlock the value. That's why you have to think big on data, more intelligence, and you will get there.
Yeah, absolutely. And it begs the thought of what we didn't know just even 10 years ago and what we'll see 10 years from now. It'll be significantly different, right? I think it's going to be a really, really interesting ride.
Yeah,
there's a lot. We talked a lot here, but there's definitely a lot to think about. Where can the viewers here go to learn more about, you know, about what we're talking about here, if they're interested in understanding more about this?
Yeah, I think the way the market is evolving, there is information overload everywhere. I think it's more than even where can I go. It's really about you should know what you want. And once you know what you want, even ask any of these like Grok or ChatGPT, it'll tell you where to go look for information. Even our own site, for example, we had a large docs site. Now you don't have to go search and read all the documentation, go through all the training. You ask a question, exactly what you want to learn. AI prepares content just enough for you to read. I think the problem of information is already behind us. It's really about what you want to learn. More than what you want to learn, ask what you want to accomplish. That is where the industry is shifting to. Previously, you just did random things and then experiment, eventually it led to like, okay, I know I got the spark. I know what I want to do. Now you think what you want to do. And once you have the right questions, you will find the right answers. And it's learning sources, all that. We produce a lot of content. We have spent a great deal of time training, educating a large force. Our user base is even larger than Amazon S3. So we spent a lot of time educating them. But I think I can give you a lot of links. I think it's no longer hard to find information. I actually just encourage them to know what they want to read, what they want to learn.
Yeah, that's fantastic. Well, I think definitely MinIO has a lot to offer here in this space around this. Ibi, thank you for joining me today on our podcast, and big thank you to all of you who tuned in. We really appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. But for today, that wraps up this episode. We'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talent shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge, building with AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. Be sure to follow us on social if you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect. You can always reach me at paulan@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.